There was even a time in Medina when the caravan of Abdul Rahman was coming from Syria, when the grounds of Medina began to shake. And upon discovering, people found out that it was the sheer weight of the herd of camels coming to Medina of Abdul Rahman, Razitar Anho, that because of their movement, Medina was shaking. This was the extent of how much Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave him after he was broken down to zero. Similarly, we know of Abu Zar, Razi Ta'ala Anho, who was regarded as the lone one. The one who was normally all alone. He was from the tribe of Ghifar, who were a tribe of highwaymen, highway robbers. They used to loot and rob caravans. And even while he was with them, he still believed in one God, and he stayed away from their activities. And when he heard that there was a Prophet of Allah who had come to preach the message of Islam, he went to him and alone he accepted Islam. And upon accepting Islam, he was so enthusiastic that he wanted to go and proclaim La ilaha illallah in front of the Kaaba. And even though the Holy Prophet ﷺ stopped him from doing so, because it was the time of the pagan Arabs and they were already very upset with these new Muslims who were coming up, he went there and he proclaimed it anyway, loudly and proudly. La ilaha illallah. Until the youth of Makkah came and they started beating him up. And every time they would beat him, he would faint. He would get back up on his feet and proclaim again, La ilaha illallah. And they would beat him again. And this continued to happen, and every time he would get up and proclaim the same thing, La ilaha illallah. Because this is the only haq he knew. This is the only truth that he knew. And he thought it an obligation upon himself to proclaim it. The youth of Makkah beat him up so much that the Holy Prophet ﷺ had to force him to leave Makkah immediately. And the next time when he returned back to Makkah, he went straight to the Kaaba with his entire tribe, who had now all of them reverted to Islam. And they all proclaimed La ilaha illallah. This was his character. The Holy Prophet ﷺ said about him, May Allah have mercy upon Abu Zar. Lonely will he live, lonely will he die, and lonely will he be resurrected. So even his resurrection will be alone. This is how unique and different he was, and a stranger he was. If you understand and look at the lives of these companions, you will see that they were embracing Islam, coming to Islam, was something which meant torture, which meant pain, which meant that you will be troubled. It will not be an easy ride. They were all aware of it. You will be beaten, your families will be threatened, and all the rest of it. Yet, many of the companions accepted Islam anyway. We know of the story of Hazrat Bilal bin Rabah, radiallahu anhu, the African slave who was beaten by his master at that time. Then we know of Khabbab ibn al-Arat, who was the blacksmith, who was tortured with his own equipment and utensils, so much so that his back was so bloodied and wounded that the companions could not even look at it. Every time they saw his back, they would just turn away, because it was so deep were the wounds on his back. They could not take it. They could not take watching his wounds. Yet these were the people who accepted Islam with a smile on their face. No problems whatsoever. The iman and the firmness of faith of these companions were extremely strong. They were never distracted by this dunya, nor any of the worldly pursuits or worldly pleasures. The Holy Prophet ﷺ himself was many times offered wealth, power, women, yet every single time he refused. If he would have wanted all of that, any of those things, he would have accepted, but every single time he refused it. He was offered the position of the chief in Makkah, given properties, land, wealth, all of these things, yet he did not even accept any single one of these things. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions to us in the Holy Quran in Surah At-Takasur, chapter 102, verses 1 to 4, Al-Hakum At-Takasur, Hatta Zurtum Mul Makabir, Kalla Sawfa Ta'lamun, Summa Kalla Sawfa Ta'lamun. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us that the mutual rivalry of piling up of these worldly things diverts you. Diverts you from what? Diverts you from the deen of Allah. Unlike the companions who were not diverted by anything, any of these worldly pursuits, this mutual rivalry of pursuit of these worldly desires diverts you from the deen of Allah, from submitting to Allah, until something happens. It will stop one day, until you visit the graves. Only then will this rivalry of pursuing these worldly desires stop, when you hit the grave. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, nay, you shall come to know. It is then that you shall come to know the haq. Summa kalla sawfa ta'lamun. You will come to know, or surely you will come to know. Because right now you are diverted, distracted by this dunya, so confused in pursuing all of these things, be it wealth, be it fame, be it acceptance from other people, but not acceptance from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It has diverted you and distracted you. But once you hit the grave, it will immediately dawn upon you what you have been up to, and the haq will become evident. A content and satisfied person is one who builds his grave with good deeds, who pleases his Lord before he leaves this dunya, who makes arrangements for his afterlife in this dunya, not relying on other things after his death, that maybe my children will make dua for me, maybe some odd person will say something for me. No, they make preparations in this dunya. They build their grave with good deeds now, and they make preparations for the journey now, not later. Sheikh Anwar Al-Awlaki has given 25 promises from the Quran that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has made to those who follow the path of the Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, who submit to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and follow in the sunnah of the Holy Prophet and the companions, who truly believe and do righteous deeds. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has promised them 25 things. I do not have the time to list the 25 things, but I'll mention a few of them. For example, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions in Surah An-Nur chapter 24 verse 55 that Allah has promised those among you who believe and do righteous good deeds that He will certainly grant them succession to the present rulers, that He will establish you on this earth. So this is a promise of Allah that those who believe and do righteous deeds, and according to the Quran and Sunnah, they will be established, they will be given authority from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. If we have not been established and given power in this world yet, it means we need to go back and check upon our iman. Why are we following Islam? What is our iman based upon? According to hadith of the Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he mentioned that Allah has shown me the entire earth and told me the kingdom of my nation will reach all of it. So the ummah of the Prophet will reach the entire earth. Islam will be victorious. The only question is, are we going to play a part in it? This is the promise of Allah. Islam will be established upon this earth for a fact. Are you going to be a part in the establishment of Islam, or are you going to sit on the sidelines and watch others while they work towards Allah's path? What will your choice be? What will your actions be? Do you want to be the part of the good news, or do you want to just step on the sidelines? And this group of people who will bring Islam back will be the ones who resemble the companions most, because these people will be upon the sunnah of the Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and living their lifestyle according to the lifestyle of the companions. And in another hadith of the Holy Prophet, he mentioned that I wish that I could meet my brothers. And the Sahaba radhiyallahu anhum ajma'in mentioned that, aren't we your brothers, Ya Rasulullah? And the Holy Prophet, peace be upon him, said, no, you are my companions, but my brothers are going to be people who will come at the end of time, and one of them would wish that they could see me, even if it would cost them their wealth and their families. So these are the people who the Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam is referring to. And believe me, this is us. If not us, our children. Because the end of time is also near. The Holy Prophet put his two fingers together and he said that my coming and the end of time is like this. And imagine now that the 1400 years have now passed. So how close must we be to the end of time? And according to all of the signs before the end of time, the ulama have a consensus on this, most of the ulama at least, that all of the minor signs have already come. We are now only waiting for the few major signs to come. And the Holy Prophet mentioned that once these small signs begin to come, they will come like beads on a string. Once you cut the string, the beads start to fall very quickly one after the other. And so the ulama have a consensus that all of these signs have come. The only signs that we are waiting for now are the few big signs to come. So these are the people who the Holy Prophet said that these are my brothers, not my companions, my brothers.